place, y'all. We want to welcome you to a very special evening here. This is in preparation for the AAPI Jazz Festival that's happening at May 20th. So for those that are wondering, what does AAPI mean? I've heard API. No, that has to do with online marketing. AAPI is Asian American Pacific Islander, includes a lot of the South Asian countries, and is more inclusive of a term versus Asian American, which usually only kind of like more East Asian folks. So the AAPI Jazz Fest started last year as an idea, actually with Victor Lin here, who you'll be hearing a little later. And it's something that is very important to us because, especially as jazz musicians ourselves, it's very hard to find situations where there's people that look like us. A lot of times we're the only Asian American in the band. And you know, a lot of times this music is accepting enough to definitely feel like you're just part of the community and that's that. But we want to explore what it really meant to be like an Asian American side, the jazz music, especially with the dichotomy between black and white musicians. Asian oftentimes gets left out of conversation. So the whole purpose of AAPI Jazz Fest was to uplift other AAPI artists' voices through the means of music, which is one of the best ways, right, to experience someone's story. And so last year we held it actually here at Clements Place, as well as Great Hall, which is that giant ballroom that you saw right out there. It was two stages and 10 artists. Really amazing time, couple local vendors here from Newark. And so this year is going to be held May 20th, Saturday, May 20th. And it's going to be held over at Express Newark, which is the Haynes & Cole building. It's just right, it's a walk down. So not too far from here. So if you accidentally come here, you know, it's not too hard to get back over there. So we'll still have two stages over there. You know, everything will pretty much be similar format. Except we have a whole new lineup of musicians. So far confirmed as our headliner, we have Takuya Kuroda. I am tripping on my words right now. And he is a great Japanese trumpet player, very much in the vein of like Roy Hargrove. And he's going to be bringing a fantastic band. We also have Julius Tolentino and Newark Academy. Julius Tolentino is the Filipino-American, but he's a great jazz educator, just like Victor Lin, as you'll find out soon. We have Reza Bassi. He's going to bring in his guitar trio. Jordan Van Hermert, who's going to be coming all the way from Michigan. And he put out an album last year called We Are Not a Virus, which was related to, you know, blame the pandemic on the Asian community. Really Chinese community, but then they kind of just group us all together. So basically, Jordan put out this album as a statement, and we definitely wanted to have him here this year. Tim Lin, who is not related to me. Victor Lin is also not related to me. Lin is just a popular last name in the Taiwanese community. And he plays saxophone. He's a great saxophonist from the West Coast. So he'll be joining us that day as well. And then repeat performance by AAPI Jazz Collective with the jam session at the end. I know that was very... It was a really nice time last year, having a lot of folks sit in. So, you know, we're really excited to be holding it again. We have a couple of events, including tonight, that will lead up to that particular day. And, you know, the whole purpose of doing these, leading up to it, because a lot of times we'll present the music and we get off the stage and that's that. So what we're trying to do now is we're trying to cultivate the mindset and trying to cultivate the conversation that happens within the Asian American community and bring that up to the forefront, especially as an Asian American jazz musician. So no better way to do that than by introducing my right-hand man and pretty much my dad, I guess, in a way. But he's a fantastic pianist and educator. And his name is Victor Lin. Let's give it up for Victor Lin. And he'll introduce. he'll be giving the rest of the introductions. I'm going to get out of the way now so I can get back to the technical directing here. And Victor Lin Trio. Yeah.
Thank you guys very much. It's a real pleasure to be back here at Clement's Place. This is kind of a remarkable stage. This is such a authentic kind of feeling experience, except it's in the middle of a college res hall, which, you know, means I was like, where's the chicken fingers and the dining points you can swipe for stuff? But I think it's amazing. I wanted to first of all again give a shout out to Peter Lin, you know, because he puts together a lot of stuff, and I'm always getting on his case about putting himself out there a little bit, because, you know, like, one of the stereotypes about Asian American men is that we're kind of invisible. You know, we don't have a lot of presence as far as media goes. We don't, you know, like, it's, there's not a lot of people who look like us in spots of visibility, shall we say. So we don't need to, like, get mad about it, we just need to do something about it. We need to just step forward and start telling our own stories, and that's kind of what the AAPI Jazz Fest is kind of about. And so to the stage, I'd like to just bring my partners for the evening, all fantastic musicians in their own right. Tonight is the first time we're actually playing together, which is another thing that's pretty amazing about jazz, and it's also pretty amazing about community building. So please welcome to the stage, from Seoul, Korea, Mr. Jeong Hwan Park, right? Jeong Hwan Park. And, he's taking a break from his regular dancer duties. He has a boy band, but he's in a K-pop group, but we won't talk about that one until he gets off his alter ego. And then at the drums, from Taiwan. Are you from Taipei? You're from Taipei. I'm actually from Taipei. My parents are from Penghu, which is a small island off the coast of Taiwan. But the drummer tonight is actually from Taipei, Taiwan. She is fantastic. She is a real leader, just even as an individual. She has a lot of thoughts about the way things are. I've had her teach in some of my programs, and she's a fantastic musician and just a real kind of like rock solid person that you really want to have in your corner whenever you're putting stuff together. On drums, Miss Wen-Ting Wu. Yeah. And finally, over there at the bar, it would be remiss if I did not acknowledge that none of this AAPI Jazz Fest stuff would even be possible if we didn't have a major, major supporter / sponsor / like huge boost of confidence in giving legitimacy. The Institute of Jazz Studies at Rutgers, New York, helmed by Mr. Wayne Winborn. And I cannot stress enough how amazing it is to have someone of that stature, or an institute of the stature that is as recognized as the Institute of Jazz Studies, you know, Rutgers, New York, which I always knew as like the largest source archive of jazz materials in the world. I came here for school 25 years ago when Lewis Porter was teaching a historiography course. And remember back then, the Institute of Jazz Studies was you have to go check it out. There's so many amazing things. And to have the backing of that saying, you know, Asian American community in jazz is something you should explore. That's an incredible boost of confidence to even have somebody take one step forward. So thanks, Wayne. Thanks, Peter. Tonight I have a couple of songs. We're going to have a little conversation. We're going to talk about how it feels to play. Hopefully you can see how it feels to listen. And hopefully we'll have a great time here at Clement's Place Jazz. And we'll take you through a few little things here and there. I hope that we'll make it so that it was worth coming here. And so we're going to start with, as I was jokingly referring to, one of the only Asian references in early American music to anything Asian. So this is a standard by Frank Lesser called Slow Boat to China.
Thank you.
That was really fun. So just a little bit about me. My name is Victor Lin. Currently, I live in New York City, and I am a pianist and a violinist, but primarily I'm a jazz educator. I'm really a people's pianist, as it were. I'm very much at home just playing tunes for people or accompanying people. In another lifetime, I was a very, very ambitious young jazz pianist who really wanted to come to New York, you know, and move to New York and take the jazz world by storm. This is like in the late 90s. And so I was a disciple of Kenny Barron's in the late 90s. I was there for his last year at Rutgers, Rutgers, New Brunswick. He retired from Rutgers to much hoopla, and then subsequently then he started working at Juilliard and the other schools, and I realized, oh, that's what retiring means as a jazz musician. It means you go to another school and start teaching a bunch of other students, which is actually really true. Most of us who are jazz educators wind up having to find as many teaching gigs as we possibly can because it's very, very difficult to sustain an actual, like, a salaried job, as it were, teaching jazz. It's still very difficult to do that. I was lucky enough to actually create a jazz program in a private school in Manhattan, and that basically took up an enormous amount of my time, and so while I was playing, I wound up figuring out how to teach jazz and make jazz accessible to high school kids in New York City. And so for the last 21 years, I've been at the Calhoun School. And one of the interesting things that I've learned is that everybody wants to participate in the music somehow. Like, jazz itself is such a cool thing, but people are, oftentimes they feel like they don't have permission to engage in it. I don't know why that is, but I do understand that feeling. I think as an Asian American, as a child of immigrants, one of the things that I always yearned to be was included. And I remember growing up and thinking to myself for a very long time how much I wanted to be white. And it shocks people sometimes to hear me say that. Now, I wouldn't ever think that now, but I remember feeling like that. I remember when I didn't see people who looked like me around. I remember when, you know, people that were thought of as successful did not look like me and who were popular. And I wanted to be popular. I wanted to be cool. And I did everything in my power to kind of go against everything that I thought this represented. Ergo, jazz. I just thought if I could do anything that was super not Asian or whatever I tended to think of as associated with what I perceived myself to be. And to unlearn that took such a long time. And one of the things that has come out of this has been this frightening realization that I have to teach my sons how to love themselves when I myself at that age maybe didn't know how to do that. And I think about this because, you know, when we talk about an AAPI, when we mention race, when we mention culture, a lot of times, instantly, people think of it as a separating thing. It's like, oh, am I included in that? But being Asian is, or Asian American, is about being human also. And it's about seeing things that you can relate to in someone else and saying, hey, that's part of my struggle too. Maybe I can walk with you in that. And I have to caution myself because I don't want to talk too much, and also I don't want to get too deep because I might just like start bawling because these are things that are really, really important to me. But one of the things that really got me started on this track of really wanting to find other people looking like me, really wanting to find people like Peter and Wen-Ting and Jeong, is finding people that have a common background but are also totally different. Because that's really what diversity is about. Not the illusion of something that looks like it's different, but something that's truly different from inside of here, and learning to be okay with that and existing with that, because that's family. And that's what we have to be if we're going to get through this whole thing together. If we're going to get through this crazy world together, you know, 1.5 degrees Celsius at a time in the Washington Post, politically, economically, Silicon Valley Bank, right? We are going to need to get through this together. So one family member at a time. Yes, dysfunctional, yes, absolutely. Crazy, yes, absolutely. And swinging, yeah, that too. So welcome to our family, welcome to our host. Thank you. So this next thing, all right, so tonight, a lot of jazz that has been penned or that has been done by Asian Americans is expressly political. And when we're talking about Asian American jazz, there are a lot of really, really significant figures. And actually, about 2 weeks ago, Peter and I were at this amazing, I think it was about a month ago, up at Columbia University. The head of the Center for Jazz Studies at Columbia University is Professor Kevin Falez, and he is of Japanese descent, which is amazing. He held a Asian American jazz symposium, and it brought over some of the real luminaries in the West Coast Asian American jazz movement, guys like John Jang, Francis Wong, you know, the late Fred Ho. You know, these are all guys who really had a bent with using the jazz music really as a form of social justice music, which jazz has a long history of, because yes, jazz is black music. And me being an Asian dude usually teaching black music to white kids, that's really strange. But that's my reality, right? It's like, without ever having to step foot into any sort of political arena, I am a political statement. And if I am not advocating on behalf of the black community, then I'm doing an injustice, because I'm sitting here playing this music, right? And I'm actually teaching it. But if I'm not acknowledging where it's coming from, then my family is really, really messed up. So that's my obligation, but that's something we'll talk about at some other point. So on the other hand, I don't think jazz or music has to always expressly be political in order to make a statement. So tonight, I'm just going to play a couple of things that I think you're going to find pretty interesting and kind of entertaining. And it might sound kind of familiar to as well. So, and then we can hopefully open up the floor for some questions also. And I have some things I want to ask Jeong and Wen-Ting. I hope they're having a good time up there. They look like they're having a good time, at least. If my time is good, then they're having a good time. Good time equals good time. So thanks for not rushing with me. All right, so this next song is one of the field of Japanese anime, you know, is loaded with great, great, great films. And along with some of those films is the music that's accompanied with it. And one of the most prolific and popular composers is the one associated with the animator Miyazaki. And Miyazaki is responsible for things like films such as Princess Mononoke and I think Howl's Moving Castle, which is the song that I'm going to play, the film that the song that I'm going to play next is from. The composer's name, I'm not sure of his actual given Japanese name, but his pen name is Joe Hisaishi. And the song that is very popular, you can probably hear this quite a bit, is the song called The Merry-Go-Round of Life. And so this is from the Miyazaki film Howl's Moving Castle. Excellent, if you've seen it. And this is probably the most well-known of Hisaishi's work. This is called The Merry-Go-Round of Life. Thank you. you. That's Wen-Ting Wu at the drums. And Jeong Hwan Park at the bass. And that was Joe Hisaishi's merry-go-round of life. We're gonna take another slice out of contemporary pop culture. One thing that I did a lot when I was growing up, I listened to stuff on the radio and I heard stuff on TV. I also listened to a lot of video game music. That's for another time. But music is all around, and stuff that affects you just affects you. And one of the things that has been very interesting to me, how many of you all have Netflix subscriptions? Raise your hand if you have Netflix. All right, so I'm seeing about like 20 people out here with. Okay, so one of the real interesting things I've seen on Netflix over the last 5 years is the abundance and continuous availability of a lot of content from Korea, China, some Taiwan, some Japan. You know, Netflix is a global thing, and there are so many dramas, you know, that have really kind of taken the world by storm that would never have been imaginable years and years ago. One of the things that has really fascinated me has been the rise of popular culture coming from Korea, you know, really kind of culminating in BTS somehow becoming like the global phenomenon that it is, you know, like seven dudes, 6'1", dance moves like crazy, you know, and literally working the boy band formula to perfection, you know, and all the way to the bank. Sure, they're, you know, they are definitely doing well. The Korean drama market has been something that's been very fascinating. A lot of my friends, in the last 10 years used to watch Korean soap operas. It used to be a thing. My parents would, literally, the Korean soap operas are a thing. And I never I'm not watching soap operas, and I'm definitely not watching Korean soap operas, okay? And then the pandemic hit, and it forced me to reevaluate so many of my life choices. And so one of the things that wound up happening was I actually got introduced to Korean soap operas. And my wife was watching this one show, and I kind of got interested in it, and then I got totally hooked. And I just like was like sobbing, and you know, I'm just like watching like these epic things. And it's amazing what happens to you when you see people who look like you represented in every different facet, you know? I mean, I'm not Korean, but still it was incredibly moving to me to be able to see an entire drama play out where like every single person was somebody who reminded me of somebody that I couldn't say I knew. And to go along with it, the songwriting and the artistry of a lot of these things, I have a distinct advantage when it comes to listening to music in that I hardly ever hear the lyrics, but it's a double advantage when it's in Korean because I don't understand a thing they're saying. I just hear them singing their hearts out. And I hear the melody, and I hear, you know, the music. My friends who are Korean, by almost to a T, they say like, yeah, stuff's a little too corny for me. Because I don't understand the words, I just hear it as like a voice as an instrument. I love all the music I heard from these Korean dramas. And so I thought I would just bring one of them that's really lovely. There's one of the soap operas that I saw was a 16-part series called Hometown Cha-Cha-Cha. And this song is this lovely ballad by the artist Yuri Choi, and this is simply called Wish. thank you guys so much. And thank you, Jeong and Wen-Ting, for playing this music with me. Like I was telling Wen-Ting, this is the first, this is the first time I've had to rehearse, I've gotten a chance to rehearse to perform in a really, really long time. So one thing that I never take for granted is an audience. So thank you all for coming out and listening to us play. We're gonna play one or two more, and then I think we're gonna probably engage a little bit in the conversation. I'm so curious, actually, after having played with these friends of mine, some of their experiences and just, you know, what they're thinking. So thank you again for participating in this. So there was a film that came out a while back that was like a big splash for, I think, you know, a lot of young Asian Americans, which is called Crazy Rich Asians. And I don't know how many of you saw that movie. I remember seeing it, and I don't know if I was particularly enamored with it, but it was nice to see representation, I suppose. But one thing I did appreciate was it got me turned on to the fact that there was more jazz, there was more intersection between East Asian countries, and or actually just Asian countries in general, and jazz than I had previously thought. And one of the things that showed up in the soundtrack, and we'll play two of these tunes, and then that'll bring our first set to the close. So the first tune, and Wen-Ting, you're gonna have to help me with this again. It roughly translates as "Give me a kiss," but it's "Gewo." What is it?
Gewo
ike wen. Is that how? Is that okay?
That's good.
It's all right.
And so,
and that basically translates to
give me one kiss.
Give me one kiss. All right. So that tune, you know, is originally it was recorded by, I think the artist Grace Chang. I think that was her Americanized name, but it was recorded in like 1958 in Shanghai. But it started out in 1953 as a song written for, I think her name is Georgia Gibbons, and it was in 1953, and the song was actually originally called Seven Lonely Nights. And I think the original song was like, you know, it was like Seven Lonely Days is fine. It makes one lonely week, right? And it was like a kind of a sad kind of country-esque sort of ballad. And there's a version of it you can find by Patsy Cline, you know, and the whole thing is basically, you know, like seven lonely days makes one lonely week, seven lonely nights makes one lonely me, you know, just, oh, I'm pining for it. So it was just so interesting to look into the history of the song, because it winds up becoming this other song completely, Just Give Me One Kiss. So this is our take on a Georgia Gibbons song repurposed as a classic Shanghai jazz song, given more life by a film about privileged Asian people with lots of money that somehow wound up being jazz. So this is Gewo again. What is it again?
Gewo Ike Wen.
Thank you. I will always have Wen-Ting around. Gewo Ike Wen. All right. So.
Thank you.
All right. So we've come to the end of our fourth time, is it? Does anybody know? We have. Hey, we're right there. We're right there. Awesome. Okay. We'd like to invite up a special guest who didn't know he was a special guest until right now to come and play this last tune with us and then maybe engage us a little bit in the conversation. Please give it up on trombone production and general all-around nice guy, Mr. Peter Lin. I was hoping you were going to do your Britney Spears, Janet Jackson thing and keep the headphone on with the dance routine. It's all good. I mean, your hair deserves a plot. I can't do that. I it's just a shrub up here, and it's going gray, so, you know, you're doing great, man. So, Peter is a world-class musician, great arranger, great trombone player, works super hard at almost everything, and yet really doesn't let people know just how difficult all of it is, so I just wanted to really kind of give him some props for managing so much of the stuff that's going on. And always trying to make people feel comfortable, always buying food for us, feeding the band, which is very important, by the way. It could be. Is it the Taiwanese thing? Feed the band?
Yeah.
That's true, because Peter worked for the IHAD, and I always made sure that I paid for lunch and that there was a lot of it. So maybe it is. So.
Just put it this way, like, food makes Taiwanese people happy.
Yes. Indeed. Same with Koreans too. Yeah. It is actually what? It's a universal thing. It's not just us. Okay, cool. Anyways, so Peter has not played with us before ever, and this is not a problem. This is par for the course in a lot of these things having to do with jazz. So this is this last song is called. Well, originally, this is a. It was penned by John Hendricks of Lambert, Hendricks, and Ross. It was penned for Louis Jordan and his Timpani Five. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Louis Jordan. Yes, thank you. Yes, Louis Jordan. If Louis Jordan is one of the most entertaining, amazing, and kind of underrated. No, I don't know. Underrated is a weird word, but he's amazing. If you want to listen to music that just explodes with life and joy, it's kind of like you can totally see where James Brown comes out of. Louis Jordan in the late 50s, right, was playing jump band, which is basically like swing music with a much tighter band, smaller. They were kind of in rock and roll, was starting to kind of hit the scene. And if you know anything also about the history of pop music, you know, R&B stands for rhythm and blues, but basically R&B was just what they named black music. So black artists at the time could not cross over into pop charts unless they, a lot of times white artists would sing their songs and they would have a much bigger market share. This conveniently gets glossed over in a lot of, you know, music history things. They just think that everything is equal. But Louis Jordan would have been an R&B artist. What's that?
Brother Beware.
Brother Beware. My favorite Louis Jordan song, I think, of all time is Ain't Nobody Here But His Chickens. But he literally, Choo 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 Boogie, like if the just the list goes on and on, man. This particular tune was literally just was written by John Hendricks. It's called I Want You to Be My Baby. And it's really easy. It literally is
I want you to be my baby now.
Right, that's actually how it goes, all right? And that got translated into one of the biggest like Chinese song hits, like popular. It became wo 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 yao wo yao wo yao ni di wo yao ni di ai. And then I don't speak any Mandarin, so I don't know the rest of the words. But this is how that song became famous. And there's a track again, probably the most well known of these Shanghai jazz kind of like tracks. Is this song called A Wo Yao Ni De Ai, which means I want your love. And I think it's really interesting because once you know that history and you see that, you know, you have, you know, jazz which is borrowing literally from within itself, but completely going to the other side of the world and becoming a hit by itself and then coming back, you know, you're using something that's Chinese to learn about something that's American, that's coming from some place. You know, it's just this amazing thing. Again, it's that thing about family. You can't really explain it, you can just be part of it. And I'm glad to be part of it. And so I'm glad for Peter to be part of this. And he doesn't know how this is going to go. I don't know how this is going to go. We're just going to play this song. It's going to be great. Thank you guys for coming to set one of Clemens Place. Again, Wen-Ting Wu on drums and Jeong Hwan Park on bass. This is either Louis Jordan's I Want You to Be My Baby or Grace Chang's Wo Yao Ni De Ai.
So let me and Peter just do the front of it, like maybe like seven or eight choruses. You and me just play. Yeah? Okay, it's E flat blues. E flat. Yeah. So just, you know how this goes, right? So you know this melody, right? It's just, do you need a tune, by the way?
No.
You sure? Okay, it's jazz, right? Can you play an E flat? Cool, that's all the melody you need. Okay, cool.
Thank you.
That's Victor Lin on the trombone, Wen-Ting Wu at the drums, Jeong Hwan Park at the bass, and my name is Victor Lin. Thank you so much for being here. We'll take a short break, and then we'll be back with a little bit more music, a little more conversation. That sounds like an Elvis song. Thank you, guys.
we'll just conversate a little bit. But I think it's pretty low key. We gotta make sure we're out of here at 10. Because there's a 10 pool. Because like you're taking, are you taking the train back?
Path.
You take path?
Oh. Path
here. Oh, I just took good. I took good. Okay, no, that's all good.
All right, welcome back to the second set here at Clemens Place.
Give it up for Peter Lin, y'all. The man with the good hair, the great smile, the new bone.
No, yeah, yeah. All that.
That doesn't sound right.
We totally.
That's a trombone. That's the new trombone. The new bone, yes, new bone. Welcome to Clemens Place, y'all.
This is a planned conversation.
Absolutely.
This is
your dad talking to you again, son.
Definitely feels like it. Definitely feels like it.
The new bone? That's right, NB, baby.
That's what it's all about.
Peter Lin, okay. All right, go ahead. What you got to say?
Okay.
We're going to promote AAPI Jazz Fest, which is...
Yeah, that's correct.
When is that again?
We're wearing here. Yeah,
look at that.
May 20th, Saturday, May 20th. It's happening from approximately 12 p.m. to 9 p.m. because, you know, it's jazz, so most likely 1 p.m. to 10 p.m. Most likely. But either way, 12 p.m. to 9 p.m., we have a whole day of music. Again, two different stages. You know, we're looking at having some vendors and whatnot, so definitely stay tuned. The best way to follow us, first of all, the Institute of Jazz Studies, which... We wouldn't be able to do this without the help of Mr. Wayne Winborn.
Wayne!
Jazz Studies. You can also follow Yarbrough Entertainment, which is the production company that's responsible for a lot of audio video live stream stuff that we do here at Clemens. And then also AAPI Jazz Fest itself has its own Facebook and Instagram. So you can always follow us there. There's a call for volunteers. I'm sure there's going to be an easy way for people to donate if they feel need, but it is a free event. It is completely free. So just come and, you know, have a good time. And it's going to be down the street on Halsey Street at Express Newark, other known as the Hand & Co. building, other known as, hey, where you go to shop Whole Foods. Okay? Right? Everyone knows Whole Foods around here.
So basically, the Jazz Fest is at Whole Foods.
Basically.
We'll be playing between the arugula and the chia seeds.
It's a very organic, non-GMO jazz.
Ooh, that's some organic blues right there.
Very nice.
And we're going to welcome back the Victor Lin trio now. All right, give it up for Victor Lin.
Thank you all for coming out. I'm considerably more relaxed. Not that I was like particularly tense before, but I did want to share with you that... The gravity of what it means to be Asian or Asian American is not something that's lost on me. And you know, earlier in the set, I was talking about how, you know, when I was younger, I didn't like being Asian very much. I didn't like what I saw in the mirror, and I tried desperately to get away from everything I associated with it. And as I've gotten older, you know, I'm actually, believe it or not, I'm 48. You know, and so I'm closing in on half a century, and I have a 3-year-old and a 7-year-old, you know, and they're little tiny versions of me, and teaching them, you know, about what it means to be Asian, you know, especially in a place like New York City, is like sometimes it's an overwhelming sort of task. And one of the things that I've realized is, you know, this is a world that is really broken and is very divided. It doesn't have to be, but it exists that way because I think sometimes people feel more comfortable when they're divided. You know, when we look for people that we belong to, or we think that we're not going to be included in conversations. You know, because it's easier to fear things than it is to try to understand them. You know, because when you're afraid of something, then it can't reject you because you're rejecting it. And being a musician, you know, and being, you know, a jazz musician and growing up in Seattle, you know, and coming here to the East Coast and coming to the realization, you know, that, well, if jazz is black music, you know, why are we only interested
in the music, why are we not interested in the lives that were led by these musicians and what the state of the world was like back then and what it was like to experience something that you can't possibly fathom. That maybe that feeling of you looking in the mirror and you not like feeling trapped by what you see is not just something that you felt. Just not knowing that, you know, like the desire to not be who you are, to fit in, is not something that only you feel. It's very, very difficult to come out and say that you feel that way. But to actually name it sometimes like takes away the power sometimes that sort of shame or that sort of feeling has over you. And the only way to be able to do that is to give it voice, to give it space, to give it sound, to give it expression, to give it what we're doing. Whether it's jazz, whether it's art, whether it's spoken word, whether it's hip hop, whether it's dance, everybody walks around with a story inside that demands to be told. More than that, it demands to be heard. But if all we're doing is trying to be heard and not doing the listening, well, you know, sometimes that's the problem with musicians, right? We want an audience, but how much are we listening to what it is that people are saying to us? And so, you know, as an Asian American, you know, like one of the things that I try to do now, more than anything as I get older, is I, even within the diaspora of what is called Asian, you know, like on first glance, if you look at this stage, you might think, oh, Asian jazz trio, cool, right? But you wouldn't know where we were from. We wouldn't know what language we speak. You wouldn't know our ages, you know? I just gave it away, but I guarantee you, if I asked you to pick out who the oldest person on this stage is, you would not win, right? There's so much stuff that you're curious about, that I'm curious about. And being able to play and to dive into music and be able to play, you know, this magical thing called jazz that just opens up more questions, that opens up lines for dialogue and understanding and curiosity, that's what we need. That's what we need, and we need to be able to answer those questions and be uncomfortable, you know, be okay with the uncomfortability that something might not sit right with you, right? It shouldn't sit right with you, right? Art at its best should promote you to action, right? Even if it's just listening, even if it's just, you know, acknowledging or saying, hey, I hear you. I don't agree with you, but I hear you. There's so much power in that. Not, oh, I don't like you because I'm not going to do this because I don't like what you say. Oh, you're terrible, right? Humanity is so much more than a like or a thumbs down, right? It's continuously trying to refine each other. It's continuously trying to find each other, right? Because that's all we want to do, right? If you're looking in the mirror, you're trying to find yourself, right? And you're trying to not get away from what's right in front of you. You want to love what's in front of you. Otherwise, you're not going to be able to love anything else around. And so if we can do that, a little bit of that through what we do tonight, then you know I feel like I'm doing something right. So again, thank you, Wayne and Peter, for helping us to get this going. And we're going to play a little bit more music for you and then talk a little bit about some of that stuff. So again, on drums, Ms. Wen-Ting Wu. And at the bass, Mr. Jeong Park. And here now, the unscripted room, because they don't know what I'm going to do, but they might follow me. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's Wen-Ting Wu on the drums, Jeong Hwan Park at the bass. That was so much fun because literally, I'm sure that some of you are regulars here. Some of you guys come and you know, like that's playing. That's as jazz, quintessentially jazz gets. No music, really. But I literally, from the first, you know, I was like, they're like, okay, what are you doing? And I just go. And John was like, okay. Wen is like, okay. Like we all have a shared common understanding of autumn leaves, apparently. And then I just checked and made sure that, you know, like, oh, you know, If I Were a Bell. And the reason actually I chose that is because the guy who wrote If I Were a Bell, Frank Lesser, is actually the author earlier of that tune, Slow Boat to China. And it's interesting because I think as musicians, and we were talking about this earlier, the more we know about the music that we play, the more we actually learn not only just about the world, but in some ways it comes back and we learn about ourselves. And so as this is the sort of the kind of like the light conversation portion of the of the evening. Jeong has a microphone, Wen-Ting has a microphone. I'm just curious if it's possible. I would really love to just hear just a little bit about, in a few minutes, just how did you become a jazz musician? You know, like, because again, like one of the things that is so important for me is not just finding people that share, but understanding them, you know, like really. So maybe I can start with you, Wen-Ting. You grew up in Taipei, Taiwan, and yet you're here in New York. New York technically right now. But here, for all intents and purposes, you know, the tri-state area, you know, like we're all trying to learn this music and play jazz. I'm curious, growing up in Taiwan, how did you get exposed to jazz and what made you decide you wanted to become a jazz musician? You can just talk just a little bit about that. Is that cool?
Yes. Hello, everybody.
Wen-Ting Wu, what's up, y'all? Yeah.
Did not expect my voice sounds like this, right? All right, so my name is Wen-Ting Wu, and I grew up in Taiwan. I'm from Taiwan, Taipei specifically. I was born in Tainan, which is like a southern city in Taiwan, but I grew up in Taipei. I started to play, I guess my first encounter with music was piano lessons. So very not typical for Asian kids, right? For piano lessons, yes. But I kind of like it. I love playing piano, but I just never liked to practice. And my parents didn't force me to either. But I joined the school band when I was in elementary school because my piano teacher was the band teacher in school too. And I don't know why I really wanted to ask her, I need to find where she is now. But I remember very clearly, she was like, you, school band, percussion. And I was like, okay, I guess I'll just go to the percussion section. So that's how I started to play percussion, not really drum sets, but more like in the wind ensemble. I was playing snare drum, timpani, cymbals, like that. And I really like it, but it was never serious. Plus my parents were like, oh yeah, also with the piano, they have the same attitude. It's just like, it's for your hobby, you know? Schoolwork is more important, and I happen to be very good at studying, so my parents were always like, yes, focus on your school, and music is cool, you can do that, we support you, but you know, it doesn't have to be your career or whatever. And I wasn't thinking that either, because it was hard for me to envision that too, because nobody in my family is a musician.
But were they musical? I'm curious. So did you hear your parents playing music at all?
No. I mean, some, like, in the car, yes. My dad really likes, like, Eagles, or, like, yes. So it's, like, very, or, like, I guess when they were young, they listened to Beatles and stuff, but they never play any music at home. It's, like, it's not like a household or here, or like I know a lot of parents, they like eat and they will play jazz, or a lot of Hispanic family, they will play like salsa after the dinner. But Taiwanese, I can't speak for every Taiwanese family, but my family wasn't like that. But I was always into music, and my parents know that too, so I was listening to a lot on the radio growing up. So, but what I mostly listened to was like, I guess Taiwanese pop music or Japanese pop music. But when I was in high school, I started to play drum set because I joined the school club, which is like a band club, and I started to form my own band. Like, we started to form our band, you know, it's not really like I'm the band leader stuff. It's not like jazz, it's more like a rock, funk kind of band. So we were all into it, and like, I was so, like, all of those, my band members or everybody in the school band, the band club, are still my best friends now. So that's how like bonded we are, we were, still are. And that's how I get into drum set. So, but I was playing more like rock and funk or pop music, but I started to listen to like Dave Wacko or like Dennis Chambers. Those are more like fusion funk drummers. And I was fascinated by them. I was like, wow, that's really cool that they play drums like that. And I was always into rhythm and grooves. So I guess that's the thing that draws me at first. And then I was exposed to jazz, I think it's almost when I was in the university, like in college. And then I think the first time I heard it, I was like, whoa, what is this? Like, how did those jazz drummer play drums like that? And it's crazy for me, because all of my life I thought drum, it's like don't bah, don't bah, you know, all those like backbeat grooves. And I was like, what are they doing on the drums? It's like almost like a sound, like a wall coming to you. And then it's just that energy, really, I didn't really understand what they were doing, but the energy of it, I was like, whoa, I need to know what they're doing. And then I started to learn more about jazz. That's the thing, because it's really hard to find. When I was growing up, it's now it's different. I'm like older now, but so things are different now. But when I was growing up, I mean, when I was in college, there weren't that many resources for jazz, but there are a couple school like jazz clubs too. So I started to go to those clubs and learn the basic knowledge of like, okay, standards and where, Count Basie, big band, and then chord changes, 2-5-1, and solo, head, blah, blah, blah. And then I started to learn more about all those different jazz drummers. And I guess it's always like the swing and the rhythm and like the, I think it's spiritual. So it's funny because a lot of people now in jazz are like, oh, we need to emphasize on like the experience of playing jazz and not just learning it academically in school. But I was never taught like that. Like, I was actually the opposite. I didn't go to any school for music when I was back in Taiwan. But I really felt it, and I think it's the spiritual side of it, like, really touches me. But I wasn't really deep enough to understand what that was. I just felt it, and I kind of want to figure out what that was and what type of life that they live that makes them play the music like that. So it's really out of curiosity and wanted to know more about the rhythm and the style and the energy and spiritually. And then I decided to work more on jazz, and I guess it all started there.
That's an amazing story. I mean, I didn't, yeah, give it up.
That was a very long story, sorry.
Yeah, but I mean, it's funny because Wen-Ting was like, I'm not very good on the microphone, please don't make me talk about this. I was like, whatever, you're great, man. Like, yeah, and just exactly that kind of thing, you know, like, I didn't know that about you.
Really?
No, I mean, I knew some of that, but I didn't know about, it's so fascinating that you pointed out the idea that you never went to school for music. Until you came to the United States, right, to study. And I think that's so, you know, that's like that changes, you know, the way you see things. You know, it's like, oh, yeah, you know, like, we have a whole other life, and yet this thing is compelling enough to want to draw us into being part of it. You know, and the way that I love the way you said that, there was a kind of like, there's a curiosity about, you know, what were the lives like? You know, and it's exactly the kind of thing. It's like, you know, you're not just listening to the music. The music is telling you a story about a person, and it's like, how, let me learn about this life, right?
It's really funny, like, when I, because now I grew older, and I know better, and I know a lot of, like, spiritual practice and stuff like that, and then I look back, I was like, that's what it was. Like, I didn't know that, actually, but I felt it. I know I felt it, and I wanted to see what that was, but it's really, like, the spiritual aspect of, like, striving and, like, trying to, you know, make things out of, like, it's almost like I have to do this, you know? And I was just like, what was that? Because, like, in Taiwan, it's, I feel like growing up in Taiwan, it's, Taiwan is, like, a great country, and it's pretty comfortable. Like, I can't speak for everybody in Taiwan, but generally, I think being a Taiwanese is pretty, it felt pretty safe. Yeah, so I was just, like, curious, like, what is that?
That's amazing. John, that's exactly the same thing that happened to you, right? In Seoul, right? That's that you were
yeah, really.
You
yeah.
were drawn to the
100% same.
100%. So John, all right. I was blown away by a little bit of what you told me at the bar just in the break. Can you maybe just tell us just a really short, how did you get interested in playing jazz or even playing the bass? And actually, when did you start playing bass is the more amazing thing to me. Okay. You know, because it's amazing. So you're good?
You're good.
Do you want to get it out for you? Yeah. I'll
get it out.
Okay.
Oh,
okay. So you grew up in Seoul, in Korea.
Yeah.
But you didn't grow up playing music either.
No.
No.
Yeah.
So wild.
Yeah. Okay. As he said before, I'm from Korea, South Korea, and of course I grew up in Seoul, and I was like Wen-Ting said, like no one in my family played music. I mean, my sister played piano, but it's classical piano.
Okay.
And I never played any music when I was in high school. I started playing music after I moved to.
What did you do mostly in high school? I'm curious. Were you in a boy band?
No, I was sleeping in the classroom. But I was kind of like music nerd. Although I didn't play any music, I was listening to music.
What kind of music did you like?
Yeah, anything like a. Pop music, pop or rock.
What did,
or
were you listening to? Like Korean pop or
like
American pop?
I was kind of weird guy. Like I never listened to Korean pop at the time. So
okay.
And
like, what was your what were your favorite bands in high school when you were in high school?
Yeah, I listened to rap at the time.
You like wow?
Yeah.
Hip hop.
Yeah.
Who did you like listening to?
Like Wu-Tang Clan.
Ooh,
like
yes. Tupac. Yeah, that's what's up.
Yeah. I'm serious. Yeah. Although I don't understand the language, but
oh, so it's like me with the K-dramas.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
But like at the flow, they speak the language like that. It's like a rhythm, like a drum machine, like drum.
So you were in Korea. You're listening to Wu-Tang Clan and Tupac.
Yeah, like Snoop Dogg or something like that.
Snoop Dogg.
Yeah.
1, 2. Oh.
Yeah. I was. Yeah. Yeah, that's my favorite song. Yeah. I was a nerdy kid.
That's amazing. Well, I mean, I don't think nerds listen to hip hop, honestly, really.
Yeah.
You can be a hip hop nerd, but you know, I mean, if you listen to hip hop.
And that back then there was like a late 90s, 1978, so no Spotify, no YouTube or anything. So I bought a lot of CDs and like also in Korea at the time it's very hard to find like CD from United States or Europe, so
wow.
Yeah, So
you were the only guy on the block with a Wu-Tang Clan singing.
Yeah, yeah. Seriously. I'm,
wow.
Yeah, I'm nerdy. So, yeah. But I didn't listen to jazz until I was 19.
Okay.
And the first record I listened to the jazz was Bill Evans, Portrait in Jazz.
Portrait in, wow. Yeah. Yeah.
And I literally slept after 2 minutes.
Oh, you fell asleep after 2 minutes of listening to Portrait in Jazz?
Yeah,
wow,
so.
Wow.
It's like a, like she said, like, it's like supposed to be like a simple beat, like,
right.
But his band is like a, like
yeah,
a, palm
like
motion a wind.
And
yeah,
wind. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was sound of wind. So, like, what is this? And I just fell asleep. So, yeah, I didn't understand what was happening in these records. But but as I got older, like, I listened to, like, around 22, 3, I listened to John Coltrane, the Giant Steps.
Wow.
And, you know, it's even more crazy than rap music. Yeah, of course. I thought, because his solo.
Yeah.
His solo is so crazy. But for some reasons, the bass line put me up. The Paul Chambers. Yeah. There's no reason that, why I like this bass sound of bass. Like, of course, I don't understand, but it really.
Right, but there's no words now.
No
it's
words.
All
yeah.
Pitch. It's all just sound now.
Yeah, just sort of only the sounds and the rhythm and the groove. So that's the beginning. That's the start
amazing.
When I started. Oh, what is this? I really want to study about this.
And just so we're clear about this, you weren't playing an instrument. You were just listening. You were really.
Yeah.
You were really intense. You were listening to music. You were kind of a self-proclaimed music nerd. But you were telling me you were going to business school at the time.
Yeah.
And then you came to the United States. You were actually in Seattle for a while.
Yeah. Actually, I and Victor were talking about the city.
Yeah,
where he was
born.
I'm
originally from Seattle, and I was like, wow, you went to SCC, so you were in community college out there, and then you were looking at music and business, and then you thought, well, I'm interested in both these things. And let me just look for a music business. And then you found that.
Yeah, right.
But then the one catch was that you had to be able to what? You had to be able to play an instrument.
Yeah.
Which is like, oh, no. Well.
Yeah. It was a bass and or drums. Yeah.
Bass and drums?
Yeah. But at the time, maybe if I would leave like bigger room or better place, I would play drums maybe because drum was also my favorite drums instrument. But at the time, I couldn't afford to buy drums, and also my apartment wouldn't allow me.
You
to
wanted
play.
To make sure you didn't get kicked out.
Yeah. So okay, let's go bass because I love bass too. So.
And so you started on a little electric bass.
Yeah.
And so how old were you when you first started playing bass?
Like 26.
26.
Yeah.
So. Oh, yo, John.
Yeah, I worked a lot.
I think that's such an amazing, it's very moving for me to hear that, right? Because again, you know, there's the assumption sometimes, you know, that when somebody comes, oh yeah, you've always played, oh you were this, you were that. You know, and when you slow down for a second, you know, there's so much beauty in the details. Just if you ask the simplest question, you know, like, well, why do you like this? You know, how did you get there? For me, I remember, I played, so I'm a violinist too. So one of the most formative musical experiences I can possibly remember was playing for the first time in a full orchestra. Just sitting, you know, I'm like 8 or 9 years old or whatever the age is that they put a violin in your hand, you're sitting there and you're back in the second violin section, but you're right next to all the percussion and all the brass for the first time. And you're playing the song and you're in this sea of sound and you're surrounded by all these people. And you're part of something that is intensely human and is really beautiful. And you can't quite explain what it is, but you know you're part of something that's larger than yourself. And it's almost like you're sailing on top of it. And even at that young age, I knew, I remember that room. I remember that feeling. I remember sawing away on the violin, just being in awe and just completely just like, this is amazing. You know, the idea of being in a space with other people making music and being surrounded by it and being made to feel so alive, you know, and it, I think that's I can hear that same sort of sentiment, even though it's completely different. You know, if it's high school Jeong Hwan, you know, like listening to Tupac, you know, if it's Wen-Ting playing with her, you know, with her high school band, you know, getting ready for whatever show they're getting to, right? I mean, those aren't things that are, I think, specific to being Asian, but nor are they even expected to be, I think. So, thank you, by the way. John, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
So, we have a couple of, we have a few minutes. I'm curious if anybody, we obviously haven't really talked a whole lot about specifically like AAPI issues, but I think one of the things is that just the fact that we are, you know, different representations, you know, like, you know, a Taiwanese woman, a Korean guy, a hyperactive Asian dude from Seattle, you know, like we have so many different levels of representation, you know, it's not just, oh, you know, like here we have this person and this person, but like so many different levels of experience, and we're all playing this music. Does anybody? Peter suggested that. Does anybody have any questions for anybody in the band, or are you curious about knowing anything? Do you have anything? This is like, oh, we got back there behind the bar, man. Yeah, so the question was, earlier I had referenced that there are the most prominent Asian American jazz musicians, if you look at them, if you do an internet search, will yield names like Fred Ho, John Jang, Francis Wong, Wak Aizu, and there is a intense political bent to a lot of their work. And you know what's interesting, and this is again, this is, I'm glad you asked that, but I'm also kind of, there's so much to this because it really does directly tie into something that's very, 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 very important to me. And, you know, I've said this before, you know, jazz is black music, but a lot of times when we look at it just as product or as something to be studied, it is never explicitly stated that way, you know. And one of the things that I am always aware of is this inability for, in general, you know, and this is maybe me stepping outside a little bit and maybe wandering into some more torpedoed waters. My experience has been Asian communities don't usually intersect with black communities very much until we get below the poverty line. You know, in which case it's universal. So it was really interesting because a lot of the work that was being pioneered by some of those Asian American jazz artists was really trying to stand in solidarity with their black brothers and sisters and using jazz music as a means of protest to also speak out about injustices against racism against Asians. And while that seems like something that's, you know, very much something you could, you know, get behind, sometimes it's not the easiest music to listen to. You know, when people say jazz, most people think about going to a nice club, you know, and having a sip of wine. Most people aren't talking about going out in the streets and trying to battle police brutality, you know. And even within the jazz community, even within jazz music, there are so many different sectors. But the Asian Americans that really rose to prominence doing music on some level, because, you know, we have a joke, there's famous and there's jazz famous, right? You know, even within jazz, right, you know, like Asian American artists are very, very, very small within, like, you know, like it's like you really have to go looking for them if you really want to find, you know, anybody of significance. But what shows up is not because necessarily of the music they made, but the reasoning behind the music they made. You know, John Jang spoke a lot about, you know, like speaking up on behalf of marginalized communities, injustice against, you know, like when he came, you know, to Colombia, when he was talking, you know, he really spoke, you know, and he was like a 70-year-old, this is a 70-year-old guy, you know, like as a composer, like every time he talked about his pieces, he was always talking about the incident that he was basing the piece on. You know, he would reference the trial of this one person. He referenced the, okay, and this is about, you know, the unjust incarceration. And I think the most prominent one of his pieces that I remember was number one, is a thing called Reparations Now, which was in reference to the Japanese incarceration, you know, the internment camps. And, you know, there's a way for music to shine a light on things that are very uncomfortable to deal with, but because it's through the lens of music, you can look at it, but you can keep a safe distance from it. You know, it's like the music acts as a buffer. And so I'd be happy to, you know, continue the conversation in other ways. But in some ways, I think even just playing is in itself it's kind of a subtle act of subversion, in that we're subverting expectation. And if we can subvert expectation about how it should sound, how we should behave, we can also begin to subvert the prejudgment of how we should treat each other. Right? So that's, you know, like to me, that's the beginnings of it. The idea that, you know, like if the Asian Americans who are very prominent in the 90s, I think specifically recognized jazz as a political music, you know, and, you know, guy, you know, and historically speaking, you know, the, you know, jazz icons like Charles Mingus, you know, Miles Davis, Max Roach, you know, using, you know, John Coltrane, using this music to make broad statements, you know, really kind of like heartbreaking in a way where we're basically, they're just telling the story because they can't do anything else, you know. And for us, you know, as in some ways as another collectively marginalized community at times, to see that, to see that we have more in common with the Black community than we might think, to me, that's like the larger challenge, you know, is like trying to look for ways in which we can actually look for communities of people that literally do not look like each other at all to find a commonality, you know, and to do it continuously, to have these sorts of conversations, these sort of back and forth, because that's what's necessary. But you can do it while swinging and having a good time too, you know. Does that answer your question a little bit? Yeah. Thank you. I'm sorry. I'm that was the best I could do under the circumstances. So we've come to basically the end of the program. I wanted to play one last tune, and this is the Wu-Tang Clan. Cash rules everything around. No. Yeah, this is the I'll be doing Inspector Deck and Raekwon and ODB's up next. So. But we'll put that on the next, me and we'll, you know, yeah, you go, that's it. Yeah, I'm going to call you Jaquan from now here. Your new group name is Jaquan. All right. So the very last thing we're going to do is a song that was made famous by the singer Teresa Teng. Roughly translated, it is called The Moon Represents My Heart. Wen-Ting, do you know what the Chinese title? What is the Chinese title? What is the Chinese title of this song?
月亮代表我的心.
Okay, so I can't that.
月亮代表我的心.
The moon represents my heart, ladies and gentlemen.
I'm like disturbing this, but I kind of want to add on to what the political thing that we were talking about, and I feel like what I would like to add on is. After I came here and I started to study this music more deeply and understand a lot of like cultural background and what are those composers, musicians were going through, and like I can't speak for them, but I feel like, oh, that makes a lot of sense. But I think everybody has their own struggle. I'm not saying like I can speak for them or I understand their pain and stuff, but everybody has their own pain, and I think that is universal. And I think that is what I learned the most about, like I first felt that spiritual thing, and I think about all the struggles that I went through, and I understand that pain, kind of, and I know I can relate to it, maybe in other circumstances, you know, like being a woman or whatever, you know, like you said, like marginalized community, or and it's really that, I feel like it's spiritual, it's also like a healing power that I find in this music, because it's really humanity that it is. It's not really just because this, because that. It's important to talk about those things for sure, but I think back to like you're saying, like breaking the barrier, and if we can all understand each other a little more, I feel like humanity, it's like a good way to put it. Yeah. Yeah, so like everybody has their own struggle, and if we can all kind of, like you were saying, like listen to it and try to understand a little more, and I think that's a beautiful thing. That's it.
Yeah. Well said, Wen-Ting. All right. So we're going to close this out with a very short and very, very, this is a really pretty song. And usually, I usually pair it with something that's a little more dramatic, or there's a little bit more heaviness behind it. But for the sake of time, we'll keep it very compact. So this is "The Moon Represents My Heart."
Thank you.
Wen-Ting Wu, Jaquan, Jeong Park on bass. My name is Victor Lin. Peter Lin again at the trombone and production. Wayne Winborn, if he didn't leave already. Where is Wayne? Okay, he left. All right, thanks, Wayne. Thank you, everybody, for coming out to Clemens Place. Thank you for tuning in, and please do come to... we have one more lead-up event, I believe, sometime in April, but do please keep coming out to Clemens Place. It's amazing that you guys have this spot, and I look forward to the day where every single one of those seats is filled. Hopefully, you know, as we continue to promote, hopefully, this music and these musicians, it's going to be hopefully easier and easier. And again, May 20th, if you want to help be part of something that is really cool and just hang out with a bunch of cool people doing cool things, making cool music, AAPI Jazz Fest 2023. I'm officially, technically, the community chair of community outreach. That just means I'm running around telling people to come. So thank you again, everybody, and good night.